I'll get started. So hello everyone, I'm delighted to be here with you today, if only virtually. I want to thank Professor Berkowitz and the Hannah Arendt Center at Bard College for inviting me to give this lecture on how we can revitalize democracy. So I recently published a book called Open Democracy, Reinventing Popular Rule for the 21st Century, where I theorize a vision for democracy that centers assemblies of ordinary citizens chosen by lot and connected to the larger public through various methods, rather than elected officials who engage their voters only every few years. So in this open democracy model, democracy is revitalized by making politics no longer primarily the business of professional politicians, but the business of everyone. So it's a res publica again in the original sense. Open democracy is thus fundamentally about re-empowering ordinary citizens as sources of law and policy. So as actual legislators and rulers, this form of revitalization taps into the intuition behind ancient Greek democracy that any member of the demos has a right to a say about the good of the community, except that I'm embedding this in a much more inclusive notion of who belongs in the demos to begin with. So a major question for this kind of democratic revitalization is, can citizens actually do it? Are they capable, that is, of making the law the way elected officials supposedly are? So that's where the case of the French Citizens' Convention for Climate, one of the many, many publics implemented in the last 20 years, is particularly worth discussing. This convention gathered 150 randomly selected French people and was put in charge of answering the following question. How can we reduce France's greenhouse gas emissions by 40% of the 1990s levels by 2030 in a way that is compatible with social justice? So a very broad and all-encompassing question. This convention was given about 7 weekends to do so, spread over a year, between October 2019 and June 2020. David Van Reybroek yesterday called this convention, I quote, the most important and boldest French policy decision on climate ever, if memory serves. And I agree with this evaluation, despite the fact that, as David also noted, the French government ultimately only passed 15% or so, between 10 and 15% of the 149 proposals, and directly opposed many. So these are mixed results, no doubt, but this process is very important still, in my view, for one central reason, which is that it represents a crucial test case for the capacity of ordinary citizens to act as what I call citizen legislators, namely citizens who are put in the position of lawmakers. President Macron promised them that if their proposals were sufficiently precise and put in a legal format, he would send them, I quote, without filtering, that was his formula, either to direct regulation, a referendum, or parliamentary debate. From a legal point of view, what this meant is that he asked of citizens to produce proposals that had to be as close to implementable bills as possible. In practice, this meant that the ordinary citizens were asked not to come up with competent ideas and solutions to climate change and social justice, climate justice, but also to be competent on the best way to translate and transcribe their ideas into a legal format. And because the task seemed to exceed citizens' competence, the mission letter by the Prime Minister made it clear that the expectation was that the citizens would actually co-create these bills with experts, including legal experts. And it's, I think, remarkable and unprecedented in the history of mini-public so far to empower citizens as pre-legislator or quasi-legislators in this fashion. Most mini-publics are convened for rather generalist tasks, such as setting a goal, for example, should we decriminalize abortion or not, or a general agenda. For example, the Permanent Council of Ost-Belgium set the agenda for the parliament of the German-speaking region of Belgium for a year, and soon now the Paris Council, the Paris Assembly of Citizens might do that for the city of Paris as well. But these are not functions of lawmaking per se, perhaps precisely because lawmaking is in too technical and difficult a task for ordinary citizens. So we have only a handful of examples that support the competency of ordinary citizens as legislators. The prior cases I have in mind are the famous British Columbia Citizens Assembly on electoral reform, because they were basically asked to tackle a fundamental law about the electoral process, and the Icelandic process of 2010, whereby a group of ordinary citizens was brought to write an entirely new constitution on the basis of the input of a randomly selected sample of 950 people and the feedback of a crowd on the internet. But those, you know, examples have limits. So they took place in smaller regions, very homogeneous ethnically regions. Here we have the case of an assembly of citizens organized in the context of a 67 million country that is also very multicultural and diverse. And because of these characteristics, the French case is a good testing ground to evaluate the capacity of ordinary citizens to come together and generate quasi-laws on a very universal, difficult, technical, challenging issue like climate justice. So I'm now going to spend some time giving you the basic facts about this convention, including the role played by experts, which is important. And then I'll derive some lessons about whether or not it makes sense to try to revitalize democracy through the use of citizen legislators. The French Citizens Convention for Climate is the culmination of a process that began with the fuel tax that the French government tried to implement in fall 2018, which went on to trigger the massive social response known as the Yellow Vests. To appease the upset and the massive, you know, and the violent masses of protesters that went on to demonstrate on the Champs-Élysées and elsewhere in the country, President Macron organized the so-called Great National Debate in February-March 2019. This was a moment of a deliberation which was meant to operate as a cathartic moment where people could vent their frustrations and analyze French problems and perhaps come up with some ideas about how to solve them. At the conclusion of this large-scale deliberative experiment in April 2019, President Macron announced the project of a Citizens' Convention for Climate. This proposal had been pushed by activists, but also seemingly emerged from the analysis of the Great National Debate results, as 12 of the 18 randomly selected assemblies organized all over the French territory had converged on the need for a different kind of governance on environmental issues. So I'm saying this because I think it's important to see the convention not just in isolation, but as the culmination of a process that started with social movements. So on the first weekend of October 2020, the government convened an assembly of 150 randomly selected citizens from all over France was convened. And they met for the first time in the Jena Palace in Paris, which is the seat of the third legislative chamber in France, so our so-called Economic, Social and Environmental Council, which had been put in charge of the hosting and organization of the convention. So here I thought I'd show you some pictures. So these are on the first pictures you see the 150 randomly selected citizens, and in the front row you see the so-called the governance committee members who steered the process from beginning to end. So you know, there are including some of colleagues and friends, Jean-Michel Fourniaud. You have the two co-presidents here. You have all the citizens in the back. You have an expert of participatory democracy here, Louis Blondiot. So and they gathered in this brutalist palace called the Jena Palace. You might ask how they were selected. They were selected through a private polling company, which used quota sampling on a pool of 255,000 randomly generated phone numbers. The selection criteria included age, gender, education level, geographic origin, whether people came from a rural or urban area and the type of job they had. Each participant was also given a daily honorarium for their participation, around 80 euros a day, in addition to having all their expenses covered. That was meant to maximize the acceptance rate. And as far as I can tell, around 30% of the people who were contacted consented orally upon the first invitation. I'm not sure the uptake rate was so high in the end, but it was pretty good initially. After arriving at the Jena Palace, the 150 were further randomly sorted into five thematic subgroups. So the subgroups were food and agriculture, housing, employment and industry, transport and lifestyles, and consumption patterns. And they would stay within those groups. They would remain identified by those titles throughout the process. The 150 citizens met over 7 weekends between October 2019 and June 2020. At the end of the process, they voted on and rendered to the government a total of 149 proposals listed in a 500-page report. Just to remind you of the question, that's the question they had to answer: how to reduce France's greenhouse gas emissions by 40% of the 1990s levels by 2030 in a spirit of social justice. Over the course of each weekend, the citizens alternated between small workshops among members of the same thematic group, plenaries of the 150 at once, discussion session with experts modeled on spin dating sessions occasionally, and informal conversations during coffee breaks, meals, and nights at the hotel. Their interactions in workshops and plenaries were facilitated by members of two well-established service providers, Mission Publique and Res Publica. In total, this grand design cost around 5.5 million euros. You can see on the pictures how, you know, this roughly functioned. They alternated between small groups, large groups, moments, casual moments of conversation, and more formal presentation by experts. I should say also that the citizens connected to the larger public to a large degree through social media, through print and TV interviews, and through local meetings that some of them organized in their home regions. They felt very strongly that their legitimacy depended on being seen and understood by the larger public, so they tried their best to connect that way. And that was considerably helped by the fact that they invited President Macron to visit them in January 2020, which generated a lot of media buzz. And in the end, at the end of the process, over 60%, perhaps up to 70% of the French population had heard of the Citizens' Convention, which basically went from being just a focus group to a major political actor. During the seventh session, so this is the sort of like, you know, representation of the schedule. There were seven sessions, and during the seventh sessions in June 2020 here, the convention voted in favor of the 149 proposals. Among those proposals were an ambitious proposal to render global housing renovation mandatory by 2030, a law criminalizing ecocide, the murder of the environment, like an oil spill, a ban on publicity for heavily polluting goods, the promotion of vegetarian meals in public schools, constraints on soil artificialization, and a proposal to add a paragraph to the first article of the French Constitution specifying that the French Republic, I quote, guarantees the preservation of biodiversity and the environment and fights against climate change. After the process concluded, President Macron welcomed the 150 in the Élysée Gardens and announced that he would take on board 146 of the 149 proposals. So against his initial promise, he actually started doing some filtering out of at least three proposals. But the remaining 146 proposals went through the process of amendment and reformulation, ultimately resulting in an official bill titled Climate and Resilience that was presented to the Minister's Council in February 2021, and after many delays, finally voted by Parliament in July 2021. There was another bill adopted in January 2021, which was meant to put to a national referendum the Constitution's modifications I was just mentioning. Unfortunately, it was vetoed in the Senate, so it didn't go through. Now, a word about the governance committee. So the convention was steered throughout the process by a special body of 15 people, including two co-presidents. The primary function of this body was to settle structural questions. For example, defining the parameters with which the deliberations would be allowed to take place. One big question was whether the mandate covered the question of nuclear energy. In the end, they decided that it didn't, for example. Other questions involved things like, should the citizens be allowed to formulate proposals on sources of financing for their proposed measures? In the end, they decided that they should be allowed to do that. They also settled procedural questions such as the number of meetings, the agenda of each meeting, the schedule and steps each meeting would require. They selected the experts and interlocutors that the 150 were allowed to consult, and they interfaced with the government and other institutions. After the second session, though, something interesting happened. This governance committee decided to include two randomly selected citizens from this group of 150 citizens. They wanted them to join the governance committee to serve as a direct liaison between the governance committee and the rest of the 150. And they rotated them after each session in order to sort of like get a clearer sense of what the feelings and preferences were inside the convention. Now, let me say a word also about the role of experts. So experts, including the experts on the governance committee, where there was, there were three climate change experts, three participatory democracy experts, and some representatives of the organized civil society. In addition to those, there were experts that came as consultants on different issues. Around 130 such experts were brought in to testify in front of the assembly at various points. And to help them write their proposals. So there was a permanent support group of 19 members that citizens could avail themselves of the help of. There was an additional legal committee of six lawyers who was created to help citizens formulate their proposals in a manner compatible with French and international law. So to my mind, the relationships between experts and citizens in this French convention went further than in any comparable precedent that I'm aware of, because it embedded experts in the protocols and also positioned them in the initial mission letter as co-constructors of the convention's proposals. If you think of other settings like deliberative polls, for example, experts only intervened as external speakers, but they don't take part in the group sessions or in the panels. In the great national debates, there were at most fact checkers, and that was it. So these are some of the facts that I thought this audience would be interested in having before I go into more normative statements. So I was a direct observer of this convention. I attended almost all of the sessions, except one that I had to witness from a distance online because I broke my arm at that point. And I have to say, this was a fascinating transformative experiment. There's a lot that can be said, and there are a lot of papers in the works by myself and many other researchers, but I'd like to focus on the key lesson that I think we can derive from the successes and limitations of this process. And the main lesson for me is that, to this question that I posed initially, can citizens produce law-like proposals that are of sufficient quality to be turned into regulation, put to a referendum, or debated in parliament? Can citizens be like lawmakers? The answer is yes, they can. And that, I should say, came as a surprise to a lot of people, including myself, because I went in thinking, well, of course, I'm already convinced by preceding experiments that they are perfectly competent to set a general agenda. But I wasn't sure that they could actually, and I also was convinced that they could come up with a version of a constitutional proposal, since that's what the Icelanders did, and there are multiple blueprints for constitutions in the world at this point. But providing an entirely new sort of set of laws or quasi-laws on climate justice, that was a new type of threshold that I had no idea whether they could actually do it. And I really don't think there's a way to oversell this. Again, 150 people who knew very little at the beginning of the process and had only 7 weekends to work on this question, and in truth, a number of webinars online as well. managed as a group to generate 149 high-quality proposals by the end of a nine-month process, which was additionally complicated by social movements. We had strikes against the government's pension reform plans in November 2019 that considerably complicated the logistics of this convention, and a global pandemic starting in February 2020 that forced a lot of this part of this meeting online. So again, while the precedence of other citizens' assemblies make this outcome less surprising, perhaps it's nonetheless remarkable. The second lesson is that in order to succeed, citizens need a lot of expert and institutional support of the same kind that elected assemblies rely on, because of course, elected officials delegate a lot to commissions of experts, and in the US to lobbyists. So we're not comparing people who do everything themselves with citizens that get the help of experts. In both situations, you need expert help. The question is, how is that help mobilized? And I think in order to avoid the risk of capture, you need to an institutional design that follows the principle of experts of, I quote a formula that is common among participatory Democrats, experts should be on tap and not on top, meaning they should be made available to the citizens, be at their service, at their disposal, but not control the process and not make the decisions for them. So is that what happened in the French convention? Well, it's interesting that it did, actually, because again, the mission letter recommended co-construction between experts and citizens, suggesting that the authorship should be sort of shared. But in practice, this is not what happened. The relationship between citizens and experts was designed by the governance committee and understood by the citizens as one subordinating expert advice and knowledge to the ends defined by citizens. In addition, even though there were many experts involved, those experts were not sufficiently numerous or present in a sufficiently sustained manner, in part because they were not paid, to be able to engage in authentic co-creation. So to my mind, the final product is really the product of the citizens, not the experts. You might say, well, but experts' ideas may still have unduly shaped the content, the substance of the final proposals. Again, this would take too long to prove, but my reading of the evidence is that the citizens educated themselves about expert proposals, and then they picked and chose what they wanted on the merit of those proposals, not based on the charisma or the pure authority of the experts, qua experts. The citizens proved many times over that they could ask tough questions and resist the pressure of expert consensus on solutions to climate change. For example, the most clear-cut example is actually that they rejected the principle of a carbon tax. That's what Macron tried to pass in November 2018. That's what all the experts, especially the economists who came to testify in front of the assembly, tried to push on the assembly. And they eventually decided not to take that on board. They also resisted normative judgments on the part of experts who told them that they needed to abide by, the Maastricht rule about budget deficits. That caused a lot of pushback from the citizens. And they even pushed back against the citizen governance decisions, and they pushed back against their voting procedures. They pushed back against the choice of experts. They pushed back against the organization, the creation of a squad that was a sort of six group that nobody really, many people didn't trust. So all this bears testimony to the capacity of citizens, sometimes smartly amplified by institutional design, like the presence of guarantors, which were impartial observers of the process, to keep the upper end and to maintain the experts in a position of advisors and supporting staff, not legislators themselves. That said, I will concede that there's one place where the experts seemingly took over and had to take over, which was the translation of the citizens' proposals into legal language. Because the only they really knew what to use that vocabulary. And this raised an almost metaphysical question. Who in the end can be the author of the quasi-bills that came out of the convention if the substance is the citizens, but the form, the letter, is the lawyers? This is a fascinating question, which nearly caused a massive rift within the governance committee. It led to the decision by this governance committee to have the citizens vote on blocks of the legal translations so that they could formally appropriate the translations performed by lawyers. But this transfer of authorship from the lawyers to the citizens was hotly contested within the governance committee. And I have to say, none of the researchers, including myself, were able to watch those fascinating debates because we were not allowed to sit on the governance committee meetings, which is a shame. But we know that the debate took place because one of the members leaked a memo about the disagreements that took place on that committee. So the divide was as follows. Members of the CESE, the Legislative Council on the Governance Committee, defended the position that it was not legitimate for the citizens to be given an opportunity to vote on the legal transcriptions in order to be able to present themselves as the authors of the legislative proposals. In their view, the authorship of the legal translations needed to stay with the lawyers. And you can see the sort of institutional self-interest playing out here. They themselves represent the traditional representative institutions. They do not want to devolve any power to citizens who need to remain in the position of subordinated consultants. The other people on the governance committee, those who perhaps believed more sincerely in people's power, in my view, including the person who shared the memo, found essential, on the contrary, that the citizens be given the opportunity to appropriate as theirs, through deliberations and a vote, the legal translation of their proposals. In the end, the latter view prevailed. I'm not sure how exactly, I suppose through a majority vote. And it is in that sense too, I believe that the citizens can be said to be the authors of the legal proposals that quasi-legal proposal that came out of the convention, both in terms of their spirit and their letter. Now, there are a number of questions that this French convention leaves open. One question is whether we can evolve and improve the design so as to empower such assemblies to self-rule rather than be governed from without by experts and professional politicians, which was again the case in this convention. Because the power of this governance committee raises a ton of questions, right? These 15 people imposed a number of procedural decisions, as well as the selection of a great deal of experts. Their choices were made without much justification or much accountability to the citizens, although things arguably improved after the second session when the two randomly selected citizens were included in the governance committee. So it's clear that the presence of this governance committee shaped the output, although again, not to the point that I think we should deny authorship to the citizens. Additionally, the service providers in charge of the facilitation of the convention, the Mission Publique and Res Publica, brought in methodological principles and commitments honed in on the basis of years of practice. They are extremely good professionals. But at the same time, these commitments were never questioned. They are not necessarily aligned with the most recent social science on what works and what doesn't. And there is potentially a conflict of interest between what they seek to achieve, which is basically deliver a product, make the organizing institution happy, and the democratic goal of producing, proposals that are truly reflective of what the citizens want. So basically, the French model raises fundamental questions about the kind of actual power and sovereignty one wants to give or can give such assemblies. Indeed, parliaments do not have a governance committee. They are not told what to legislate about from without. They have full sovereignty over their agenda, their deliberations, and their ultimate decisions. And it's not clear to me whether randomly selected assemblies can develop the same ability. I think we have reasons to believe they can, because the ancient Greek council, the boule, had 500 citizens on it. They were three times larger a body than the convention, and they did manage to set their own agenda and function without an external governance committee. So surely, given the technologies that are available today, a citizens' assembly should be able to do that as well. A second question that the convention leaves open is whether citizens who have gone through this process of belonging and deliberating in an assembly are still ordinary enough or are they becoming too much like professional politicians? So it's a powerful objection that's often raised against mini publics that lasts too long, because if the whole point of revitalizing democracy through the use of assemblies appointed by lot is to return politics to an amateur sports, even when supported by expert knowledge, aren't we losing that if we institutionalize randomly selected assemblies and give them permanent powers? Note that this is a question that divides the citizens involved in this experiment themselves. So in the French case, 60% of the respondents to the researchers' questionnaires in the seem to see themselves as representatives of sorts. And another worrying fact is that they chose not to put to a referendum most of their proposals, only one, they decided to put only one, because they feared that the rest of the public wouldn't have enough understanding of what they were trying to accomplish. They feared that they would be misjudged and misunderstood. And so fear prevailed in the end, fear of the old fellow citizens. That was a very sad moment, actually. One of the governance committee burst into tears after that decision. But my reading of this is not necessarily that this proves that they became professional politicians themselves who cannot trust the public. To me, it's got more to do with the French context and our historical use of referenda, which is very plebiscitarian. And also the fact that for various reasons, the 150 were not given all the facts that could have helped them make a more enlightened decision. In particular, they were not told what pollsters and social scientists knew at the time, which is that 81% of the French population, 74% of the French population was supportive of their idea of global housing renovation, for example. I thought at the time, for sure, this is too coercive. The French won't like it. If it's put to referendum, there's a good chance it will be rejected unless there's really high quality deliberation ahead of time. So I wasn't sure. Turns out in the polls, when asked, 74% of the French population was behind that idea, which was the main lever to curb greenhouse gas emissions. So the fact that the pollster and the social scientists decided to withhold this information in the name of scientific neutrality and the desire not to interfere, actually probably played against the decision to put things to a referendum. Still, all that granted, power corrupts, as we know. So how long does it take for power to get to the heads of ordinary citizens put in such assemblies? There's more I could say, but to my mind, it's too early to conclude anything. We'll probably learn more about the professionalization risk from observing institutionalized permanent assemblies with the duration of a year or more, like the German-speaking region of Belgium Council, or now the council that's going to be created in Paris. So in conclusion, to my mind, to recap, the lesson here is that one could imagine a revitalized democracy in which assemblies of citizen legislators, preferably larger than 150, which is in my view too small, are constitutionally authorized to make and vote bills, thus making laws in the full sense of the term. Note that this would not necessarily render elected parliamentarians redundant, as the latter could still have their own legislative autonomy on a bunch of issues, and on the basis of the mandate given to them by voters. Additionally, the function of keeping government accountable and functioning as a place of contestation, checking executive power, might still be best performed by an elected parliament rather than a randomly selected assembly. So I'm not saying we should necessarily get rid of elected assemblies. I'm just saying that there should be room made for the autonomous legislation of a randomly selected assembly. Given the Athenian historical precedent and the demonstration by the French Convention that citizens are competent enough to act as quasi-legislators, the ideal of a version of rule of the people, where legislative functions are in the hands of citizens, suddenly seems a lot less utopian and possibly within reach. And I'll stop here. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Helen. Is this working?
Yeah, I'll I should go, yeah. I'll just give a short reflection on this wonderful presentation. Thank you so much, Hélène, for this insightful story about the French Citizens Assembly, which I think has been very inspiring for many other citizens, Climate Citizens Assembly all around Europe. Climate activists, Extinction Rebellion, Fridays for Future, but also, of course, democracy activists have been pushing for Climate Citizens Assembly for a long time, and for a long time it remained a theoretical exercise. And the French Citizens Assembly on Climate really made it clear to many, especially politicians, that this is not a theoretical exercise, that you can actually do this. And I think the French Assembly really sparked climate assemblies all over Europe the last year. There have been climate citizens assemblies on a national level in the UK, in Denmark, in Germany, in Scotland, and on a local level in many, many places. So it's been really an inspiration, and many lessons have been learned, of course. I think you're absolutely right when you say that the French Citizens Assembly and the ones that followed absolutely proved that citizens are very capable of developing intelligent, ambitious, adequate climate policies, climate law. And that's very important. I think it takes away a lot of the skepsis, not only among politicians, but among citizens themselves, that fellow citizens can actually have a very intelligent view on climate change and come to very intelligent proposals. That being said, there are some things I would that came to mind when I listened to your talk, and also, of course, while observing the French Citizens Assembly. Three things. One has to do with the remit, one with the deliberations, and the final point I would like to make is about the political follow-up. But first of all, the remit, I think, as you also said, it was a very, very broad question that people were that people had to answer, or you could say perhaps the group was too small. What you saw was that the 150 people were divided into five subgroups. They were there were only 30 people actually discussing specific topics, which made it very difficult for the whole group, so the 150 people, to hear all the information and to talk about all the topics. As a result, you could say there was not one citizens' assembly, there were five small citizens' assemblies of 30 people. So perhaps with a large topic like this, it might have been better to either have chosen 600 people to discuss this this topic, or perhaps to have organized five parallel citizens assemblies of each 150 people. And that also relates to the deliberation part. As I said, that the deliberation really took place in silos, I think. One of the major forces, I think, of major benefits of citizens' assemblies is that it really taps into this collective intelligence. And when you divide a citizens' assembly into much smaller groups and not everybody has the chance to hear all the information and to discuss the various topics, it makes it very difficult to tap into that collective intelligence. It makes it much smaller. So that's, I think, was a little bit of a shame that collective intelligence wasn't tapped into more. And Yeah, and also another thing I was wondering about the information that the participants received was not always very balanced. I believe that, for instance, some of the politicians that had a say could speak for 50 minutes, and an NGO, for instance, talking about degrowth only had 5 minutes to make their point. So that also leads to some information inequality, which makes it probably very difficult for the participants to really make a fair judgment of the information. And then a final point, the political follow-up, of course, I think everyone working on citizens' assemblies was absolutely enthusiastic when Macron said, "Well, we will. I will accept the recommendations unfiltered." But in the end, it was very clear that he made a promise that he couldn't keep, and that only about 10% of the recommendations are actually put into law. Many of them are watered down. And I think this has the effect of a lot of frustration among people, among the participants in the first place, but also wider society, who now get another example of politicians saying one thing but doing something else, not keeping their promises. So I would wonder, how would you feel about designing citizens' assemblies in a slightly different way, making sure that there can be political follow-up? So already in the preparation phase of the citizens' assembly, make a plan for political follow-up, make sure that there is a clear mandate, and that the political authority who gives that mandate is also the authority that can keep up that promise. I think that designing for impact is something that is not yet it's not being developed optimally in many of the citizens' assemblies. There's a lot of focus on the deliberating process, but not so much on the political follow-up. I would be very interested to know what you think about that. How could we make that political impact greater, and make sure that all that energy, all that intelligence that is being captured in citizens' assemblies, that can actually materialize in the recommendations getting the proper political follow-up?
Thank you so much. These are really excellent questions. Should I answer them right now? Yes? Okay, let me try. On the size, I think that you're right. For me, this was clearly also too small, but you have to realize again that, you know, this was a kind of a first, right? So there was a budget that was limited. I think that in the future, as we are learning to master the skills that are required to organize these kind of things, and the manpower was, borderline lacking when it comes to the two organizations that facilitated all of this. So if we move to 300, that would be probably the next step. I know that, for example, Jim Fishkin, in his deliberative poll, regularly convenes 400, 500 citizens together, but he rarely does that on a sustained, in a sustained manner over months. So I think the solution here is quite simple. It's just money and experience. So that eventually, I think, will be solved. I agree that was probably too small. I agree less with your diagnostic that this convention was, in the end, five separate citizens' convention on different topics. I don't think you would say of a parliament that it's several parliaments in one, just because there are separate commissions working on different things. I think a division of labor is unavoidable. Perhaps it wasn't done sufficiently well, and there should have been more efforts made to integrate the conversations taking place in the different subgroups. Do parliaments do a better job? I'm not sure. What was tried here was quite interesting. I mean, they had this moment of cross-pollinization where they send a subset of each group to another thematic subgroup to basically bring in a fresh perspective and new questions. And and at the same time transfer some amount of information from, say, the housing group to the production group, right? So, and then they built on those bits and this exchange of information at the local level in the plenaries, where they try to pool the findings and the main arguments developed within the context of a smaller group. So, I mean, this was not perfect, but I think it's a bit extreme to say that these were just five separate groups. I don't agree with that. The deliberation, for the same reason you say, well, the deliberation failed to tap into the collective intelligence of the group. Probably it didn't tap all what it could have tapped, that's for sure. Again, it was very imperfect. The information was not fully balanced, I agree with that. I think the solution to that is to give the citizens themselves perhaps more control over the choice of procedures. Because again, like you also have to give credit where credit is due, because this was done at a speed and under conditions of of stress, and I mean this was a big endeavor, and so I think that everybody was doing the best they could in terms of organization. So yes, ahead of the process, they should have thought through some things better, including how to let citizens have a say about which experts to bring in and make sure the perspectives were balanced. I'm not sure that was done very well, but I think it's something that could be fixed by, as you said, more preparation, no doubt, and learning from those mistakes, actually. And then the political follow-up, absolutely agree with you. This was such a letdown. I also, really was excited by the promise and the scope and the potential impact that this could have been, especially as really like the citizens themselves did manage to raise the status of the convention, make it known to the wider public. This poll that says that 74% were behind their proposal for a housing renovation, this could have been huge, So designing for impact, yes. I don't know how you do that, though, because in a way, it all depends on the willingness of existing representative institutions to let go of power. And that's really hard to get. You need insiders who really believe in it. But even when you have a Macron who at least said initially that he believed in it and wanted to let go of power, he was kind of letting go of a power that he didn't have. It was the power of parliament in some respects. So the fact that he gave so much power in theory to this assembly actually alienated parliament, because parliament saw it as a way for Macron to bypass it by trying to manipulate a group of 150 citizens into promoting a carbon tax or some other proposal. So this was not done really well in the French context because of the history of the relationship between the executive and the parliament. And I think the Irish case is much better, and maybe that's a route that should have been followed, which is that they first went for a hybrid assembly that convinced parliamentarians that, oh, this is working, this is not a threat, we actually can trust those people to do good work and we'll benefit from it down the line, So that's how they passed marriage equality in Ireland, right? In 2015, they had an assembly first of that was hybrid. 66. Jane Souter talked about it yesterday, so I probably don't need to rehearse this. But that was a very smart move, because then they could move to purer form, and the parliamentarians were like, well, we'll trust the process. And there was none of that preparation in France. You could say the Great National Debate was a pre-preparation, but that's not true. I don't think many legislators were interested in what happened in those regional mini publics. And it was also too early, probably it was just 6 months before. So I think that, I'd like to hear more from you, actually. How do you think we should design for impact?
Well, I wish I knew too, of course, but I think it would, it would be very important to know what the exact mandate is. I think that was not clear enough in the French Assembly, but in many other climate assemblies, it's not very clear as well. I think making very clear, having talks with the political authority beforehand, and really reaching a consensus on what the actual political commitment is beforehand, And on what conditions, that could help a lot, I think. For instance, if there is a political commitment saying, well, if there's 80% consensus on a specific proposal, we will implement it, except there is, I don't know, financial or legal restrictions to it, but that you can set a certain condition beforehand saying that every proposition with more than 80% consensus will be implemented unless. I think that would help a lot. I also think it would help a lot to develop a time plan beforehand to say we will present the proposals in, I don't know, September, and then in November there will be a first evaluation. Just to make a plan with specific steps so that not only the participants but also the rest of society knows when the political authority will make clear what they will do with it and in what time frame. So there also can be some monitoring and analyzing what is actually being done and what still has to be done. So clear mandate, specific commitment, and a time plan would be something to start with, I think. Perhaps there are other many questions. Yeah.
Hello?
Yes, we're here.
Okay. Can I say something? So I have a question for both of you. What if these citizens' assemblies said there is no... So what if these citizens' assemblies said there is no problem with the climate? Oh. There is no problem. I mean, this is the old agenda-setting problem. In every parliamentary system I know, one important issue is what gets put on the agenda. So, you know, how does this citizens' assembly evade that problem?
Well, so as I said at the end, I think that the next step is to give citizens' assemblies the power to set their own agenda. So the French Convention didn't have that luxury, definitely. But we see that, again, in the case of the East Belgium Council, the Council of 27 randomly selected citizens had that ability to set its own agenda, in fact, set the agenda for parliament, for the local parliament. So that's a better way to do it. That said, I'm not sure if your worry is about the lack of ability to set your own agenda or the worry that they will set the wrong agenda, right? Or both, yeah.
Or both, yeah.
Yeah, well, I just don't think that a large enough group of citizens would depart very much from the consensus in society, and you know they would just reflect what are the shared fears and interests of society. So that's kind of what you want in a democratic government. So if you can cite me a country where they don't believe that climate change is an issue, then that's what you would get in your randomly selected assembly, at least initially. But I'm not sure that sounds like a very theoretical worry.
The other question, which I think is relevant, since Hélène, you use this term in your book Open Democracy, and you used it too. Is this idea of collective intelligence. Again, this is a version of my first question. How do you see this? Couldn't it be the case that the collective intelligence says, well, there's no problem here?
Yes, again, very theoretical worry, but let's take it seriously for a minute. Sure, collective intelligence is not a guarantee of collective wisdom. It just takes the information and facts and perspectives at a given moment in time. And if you took the collective intelligence of the Romans, they would tell you that it's okay to throw people to the lions, you know. So that's, you know, but the thing is, compared to what? Compared to the intelligence of a smaller group? I don't think the smaller groups in the Roman times would have been that much more enlightened. And today they aren't either. So, you know, you have to compare. What are your alternatives? We're not talking about a perfect solution with perfectly benevolent experts who know everything. This just doesn't exist. The alternative is, you know, a government where people don't have access to the entirety of the information they need, which is distributed in the entire country and needs to be filtered through a diversity of perspectives. And what you can get in a citizens assembly, which gets you a little bit closer to that. I actually thought the worry was going to say to be that all collective intelligence. Do you assume a correct answer? Because I heard Professor Berkowitz really against that idea.
So yesterday the question came up about Viktor Orban in Hungary. You know, he's a popular guy, and a citizens' assembly there could say, well, go ahead and be a dictator. That would not, at least, we would not think of that as revitalizing democracy.
No, absolutely not. First of all, for extreme sort of like risks, we tend to, you know, entrench constitutionally the norms we don't want to see touched by majoritarian judgment, right? So a citizens' assembly would never be allowed to deliberate about whether or not to take away the rights of an ethnic minority. That's just not something that I think in constitutional democracies we would consider a domain for citizens' assembly reflection. So you can take away a lot of the worries that way. And then again, I think that, so similarly for the dictatorship, is the citizens' assembly going to vote for a dictator? I don't think that's something that would be on the agenda if you constitutionalize the principle of, you know, there can't be a dictatorship like that. That's not part of the framework. Can they make mistakes? Absolutely. But do elected governors make mistakes all the time? Why is the bar perfection for citizens' assembly? You have to let people learn from their own mistakes as well. So consider that sometimes, because an objection I heard yesterday was that, well, do you like citizens' assemblies because they produce liberal solutions? But they don't always produce liberal solutions or progressive solutions or environmentally friendly solutions. Yeah. Consider that in South Korea, a few years ago, there were deliberative polls conducted in the country about the fate of 5 nuclear reactors and whether they should be closed or continued, because they were being some of them were under the process of being built. And they brought together a few hundreds of South Koreans who thought about it really hard and long and consulted experts, and they came up with the conclusion that economically speaking, they couldn't afford to close those plants. Mm-hmm. So, you know, that ran actually against the president of the country's wishes to close off those, to terminate those plans. So sometimes you won't get the outcome you want. Yeah. For example, perhaps Macron thought that, well, for sure, the citizens will get behind the principle of a carbon tax, because that's what economists and experts around the world keep telling us is the only solution. You need a strong price signal. They refused it. Maybe that's a mistake. Yeah. You know? Yeah. But I don't think that's a reason that the possibility of mistakes is part of the human condition. Why are we forbidding citizens to make mistakes when we tolerate constant mistakes by elected governments, right?
There are two questions in the room, so.
Yeah. This person here. What?
No, the next to you.
The woman there. The person
Hi.
Who has the mic.
I'm the woman here. Yasmin, sorry. Thank you so much, Ellen, I think, if I'm not mispronouncing it, and thanks Eva, and thanks Uday for moderating. This is fascinating. I learned so much, and I continue to be fascinated with this project of sortition. I have a question that is, I guess, two-parted at least. So first of all, you mentioned that you were not able to observe the assemblies. Is that about you, or is it, because I think there were observers, but I wonder if there was a resistance to becoming experimental subjects on the part of the assembly, and I actually commend that. That's wonderful. And we were, when you mentioned the conversations that were happening, you talked about the ends of citizens. So I believe this is the ends that are articulated by the citizens, whereas the ultimate end or goal, it was the mandate coming from the government. So I wonder how you think of the perhaps principles that may have accompanied these conversations, and by principle I mean these Arendtian, I guess, notions of like plurality, equality, equity. And I wonder if you could speak to that. And on the question of, for instance, the resistance to the policy of carbon tax, I'm assuming there was a principle that enabled that resistance, because it seems like a wonderfully feasible policy, but then there must have been some resistance. So I wondered what you thought about that. But thank you so much. I'll stop right there. This is fascinating. And also, oh yeah, the backlash. Could you speak about the backlash? Because I think there have been petitions afterwards. So I wonder whether that is also a democratic sort of experience or participation on the part of the people after Macron's basic, like, you know, overriding the whole thing. Thank you.
Okay, well, that was a lot. So let me try to address some of that. So actually, can you remind me of your first question? That was the one I was focused the most on, and then I lost it.
Was it the resistance of becoming like experimental subjects?
Yes, exactly. Yeah. We were allowed, researchers, we were about 30 researchers from different disciplines. We were allowed to sit on all the meetings of the convention. There was a reluctance at the beginning to allow us to talk to citizens, and we were allowed to talk to them, but very minimally, because they actually wanted to talk to us. So it was very hard to just like be stone-faced and just turn them down. So we were there. We were able to follow the conversations in small meetings, large meetings, although we were sitting in the galleries above the plenary meeting space. But we were not allowed to sit on the meetings of the governance committee, which is this body of 15 members that made very important decisions about agenda setting and procedures and voting methods and all of that. That was not accessible to us, which is huge missed opportunity, and I hope they don't do that in the future, or at least they keep recordings or some kind of documentation of what went down in those meetings, because now we're all we have are the testimonies and email exchanges and archive materials that was produced during those meetings, but we didn't see anything. We couldn't tell the body language. We can't access all of that. And in terms of the backlash at the end, yes, people were very disappointed. The 150, have formed an association to continue the work of the convention. It has its own problems because it turned into a kind of electoral politics there, because it chose our president through election. And of course the initial president was like the most charismatic and electoral type of the whole assembly. He ended up publishing a book called I Citizen, which is the complete opposite of the idea of we, the convention. So the logic, basically the sort of like electoral partisan star obsessed logic of the outside ecosystem parasited a little bit, the deliberative collective logic of the convention, but that's kind of to be expected. And I don't know, until we get to a tipping point where the norms are shifted, I think this is going to happen. And you asked me about the principles of equality or inclusion or that took place in the convention. I should say that, it was not perfectly rosy. I mean, there were examples of sexism, there were examples of racism, there were examples of exclusion that happened. That too needs to be addressed. I mean, the French society is in a period of reckoning with all kinds of things, actually. And of course, these things manifest themselves in the context of this micro public. For example, you know, we had representatives of our overseas territories, which are basically our former colonies. And you would expect that their views would be front and center, you know, on something like climate justice. I mean, they represent, these territories represent 70% of French biodiversity. Yet, I think it's fair to say that the metropolitan voices were heard a lot more. Although the representatives of those territories did organize, and I think they pushed back, and there was some progress, but in the constraints of what is currently the distribution of hegemonies in the French context. So on the carbon tax, the reason why they resisted so much, it's interesting, the carbon tax, because when French researchers distributed a questionnaire on the carbon tax, first of all, we got pushback because they thought we too were trying to manipulate them. So they were so suspicious of the whole exercise coming in. It was incredible. Second, when they answered the question, are you, you know, in favor of a carbon tax, a small majority actually said they were. So funnily enough, in the privacy of the questionnaire, a small minority said they were in favor of a carbon tax. In the context of an open debate in a plenary, where some really loud voices like pushed back against the experts who promoted that view, all of a sudden, the convention went for, well, we're not going to touch the carbon tax. So there are two interpretations here. Either you say, well, the silent majority was bullied into silence by the loud vocal, you know, opponents. That's one interpretation. Another interpretation, which I think is more correct, is that, you know, there was a great desire in this assembly to stay together as one. And so if they sensed that there was too much resistance on the part of a vocal minority, they took that very seriously and they changed their minds. And you know, if they only lukewarmly supported the carbon tax, they said, okay, let it go. Let's just forget about it and find other solutions. And that's actually potentially a good thing, right? Because it shows that even within a deliberative context, some minorities at least can be taken very seriously and in fact shift the preferences of the expressed preferences of the majority. But I'm not sure. I mean, this is something where you have to conduct a lot more interviews and to figure out what exactly happened.
There's a question. Yeah.
Hi, Helene. My name is David van Reybroek. We know each other.
Yes. I don't see you, but I know you.
Okay, I see you, and you're on a very big screen. Something has struck me during this talk, which I thought was a fantastic summary and analysis of what happened in France. But it is this idea that citizens' assemblies need to be perfect. You just addressed it as well. To me, this is utterly strange, given indeed the weaknesses of what we have now. If we plan to design citizens' assemblies, it is not about reaching heaven. It's about avoiding hell, and we tend to forget that. And then secondly, on the question of political implementation, the political uptake of the recommendations by the citizens, I recently published an article on a tool called the preferendum. You just shared the very interesting observation that the participants at the French convention were reluctant to give their well-thought recommendations to the almost visceral reactions of a referendum. But a preferendum would perhaps be a more interesting, a smarter form of a referendum, where you would have their 149 recommendations, perhaps chopped in chunks of 30, generated by a carousel, 30 every time, where participants could rate, agree or disagree on each proposal and highlight which proposals they would find best. Again, it's perhaps not heaven, but might it help to avoid hell?
Okay, I absolutely agree with both points. The point about, you know, it's not about reaching heaven, it's about avoiding hell, absolutely. I do understand, you know, the caution of those who say, well, you know, it's the devil we know versus the devil we don't. So maybe the bar is higher for citizens' assemblies. They have to prove more and answer more objections. But at some point you have to ask, okay, how many objections do we have to answer before we get a fair trial, right? So it seems to me like a lot of these objections come from a place of bad faith and resistance to change rather than caution that would be justified. On the referendum issue, absolutely. I do think, though, that in a French context, what was perhaps even more important than the referendum at this point was that we'd have been able to organize a multiple choice referendum, meaning like it's not just about rating and ranking the option, is that there are multiple options, even if you just use the classical majoritarian sort of voting. Because the problem with the history of referendums in France is that they are plebiscitarian, and that it would have inevitably become a for or against Macron vote. And if that was it, then, you know, it might have gone wrong. But if we had followed the Irish route of having multiple questions put to people in the referendum, then it becomes really a discussion and a decision about the substance, not the person that happens to be in power at that moment. And I mean, in an ideal world, we'd combine all these ideas, you know, we'd have like a citizens' assembly with actual, you know, legislative powers, but that also puts some of its proposals to a referendum with multiple choices. I mean, this would be a very different world, and I think a much better one.
JC.
Thank you. I'm Tracy Strong. Thank you, Hélène, for a very interesting talk. I was struck by the fact that you spoke, as one would in France, of a convention, of a convention, whereas most other people have spoken of assemblies or consuls or so forth. But they all actually have something in common, which your word actually brings out more centrally, which is they all have an instigator, or they all have someone or somebody which called them. And I was wondering if there's, and we had yesterday, we now have a total of 8 or 9 or 10 of these experiments, these conventions, these assemblies all around the world. I was wondering if there's anything that can be said about the quality of those or that which calls them, which instigates them, which brings them, allows them to come into being, because they don't just happen. Thank you.
Yes, well, they don't just happen, in part because they're costly. You know, you need funding and you need sort of a logistical support that typically bottom-up groups have a much harder time gathering. And you're right that in the French context, they called it a convention, in part because I think in the mind of the, for example, one of the co-presidents, I know for a fact that he thinks conventions should be rare occurrences. He really is opposed to the idea of turning that into any kind of institutional permanence. And so the term convention also reflects that sort of premise of the French process, that it's something that needs to be rare. The people assembled vicariously, and so it needs to be rare.
I didn't pose the question correctly. What happened yesterday in Paris, for instance, could not have happened without Hidalgo. The question I'm asking is there something in common about the people who are the instigators? Where are they politically? What is their background? Why are they doing this? What leads them to do this? What is their motivation? Is there anything that can be said in general?
I have no empirical evidence to back this up. It's just an intuition. I think it's pure political opportunism, you know, and it's smart, honestly. In the French case, you look at how Macron came to these ideas. I don't think it was in his intellectual DNA necessarily, although you might say that the way he created his party and his movement and the appeal to collective intelligence in some of the early stages kind of like could have led him this way. But I think it's more that, you know, there's a serendipity about all these things, but he faced a social movement that got really violent, you know. What could he do? Repress or talk? He went for the talking strategy. Then that led him to talk to people in the space of participatory democracy who said, including the CNDP, which is a very important and interesting institution in France that initially was in charge of the great national debate and then wasn't, but really has a culture of participation that runs very deep and that made it necessary to include randomly selected assemblies in the process. So Macron took that on board. Then it worked. Then, and I wanted to share a slide that I didn't show in the end, but I'll show it now. These 18 randomly selected assemblies converged, I said that at the beginning of the talk, they converged on the idea of a new form of governance on the ecological transition. It's this leaf here that shows that, so it says, renew the governance to successfully complete the ecological transition. And you see there are like 12 little leaves, and they correspond to 12 of the 18 randomly selected assemblies that were conducted in the regions during the Great National Debate. And apparently, according to a source that I trust, this slide convinced Macron that maybe if he did something after the Great National Debate, it should be a convention on climate. So also your idea that you know, it comes from the top. Yes and no. Yes, it comes from the top, but it's also pushed from the bottom up by social movements. There's no way Hidalgo or Macron would have gone for these things if activists hadn't pushed for them for years. I'll mention also the role of Cyril Dion, who's a documentary maker and activist. He's been pushing for this idea. He met with Macron. I would also credit David Van Reybroek here, who apparently gave his book Against Elections to President Macron shortly before all these events. So it's a confluence of factors. Ideas are there, and then when you're trying to score points and become popular, you also go with the ideas that are currently in the air, I suppose. And you know, there's this OECD report called subtitled "The Deliberative Wave" that documents upwards of 300 cases of mini publics, not all of them citizens assemblies, but you know, randomly selected bodies. So it's clearly the right direction if you want to try new things and think that you know you can attract in particular a progressive sort of left-wing population, but not only. When you look again, I'm completely struck by that finding that 74% of the French were behind the global renovation proposal, because it's bipartisan. Everybody knows it's going to be costly, but everybody knows it's necessary, left and right. So I think that's just smart politicians see that and they go for it.
Web.
There.
Alison Stanger, Middlebury College and the Hannah Arendt Humanities Network. Thank you so much for a fascinating presentation. And I may have missed something, so my apologies if you spoke to this. But I couldn't help but be struck by the odd similarity or pattern in the numbers. 150 citizens, yeah. 149 proposals. Can you say something about the process by which we got to the end point? Because it sounds like maybe everybody had their own proposal and they collected them all together.
So I'll tell you, it's worse than that. It was actually 150 proposals, but then one didn't get voted. So it ended up with 149. So it looks very suspicious, but I think it's genuinely, large part an accident. The proposal that didn't get voted during the final session was by the citizen assembly member, is the one that aims to reduce the working week to 28 hours. Too many people said, look, we're already going to look like green ayatollahs. If we do that, we're going to look like communists. Forget it. Let's not do that. So they took that one out. Was it one person, one proposal? No, I don't think so. Because the way I've seen the proposals evolve, it was more like, quite organic and they went from 30 proposals to 25 in one group to, you know, so I can't say it's not an addition of proposals. That said, there were some proposals that were strongly identified with one person or one group of person. For example, the ecocide proposal clearly came from one citizen who very early on in the process put it on the table, fought for it, convinced others to get behind it, which then led to the assembly inviting Nicolas Hulot to also talk about it. You know, so there were natural leaders in this group that came with ideas or developed ideas within the context of this assembly, and they invested all their energy behind those. But doesn't mean, I don't think you can say that as a result it's just an addition of individual proposals. They were very organically tied together and constructed together.
Any other questions? Any other questions?
Hello. My name is Andy Arnold, and I teach at Kutztown University of Pennsylvania. And my engagement with Arendt has to do with the origins of institutions, how they're formed and how they develop institutional cultures. I'm fascinated with this idea of capture, and I'm wondering if you can talk more about expert capture and the development of institutional culture within this assembly. And then secondly, I wonder what would happen when we have a lot of these. Will they develop norms? Will they develop just standard ways of solving problems and institutional cultures?
So I think expert capture is a real danger. It's already happening in our government, so it's there. Agencies, administration, they've accumulated an enormous amount of power that's very constraining. And in fact, maybe that's where, you know, some people say that that's, we live in technocracy, that most of the actual decision power is there because they actually are efficient at getting regulations and things and churning out new constraints, whereas parliaments are paralyzed and very powerless. So in the context of citizens' assemblies, is it likely to happen? Yes. As I said, I've seen attempts by the superstructure and the experts to consciously or unconsciously, actually, a lot of the time it was, I think, unconscious, control the narrative, the flow of ideas, the normative presuppositions. But I also think that there's no iron law of technocracy. I don't believe in those deterministic sort of things. You can build a design that's resilient and robust to these kind of attempts. And so, for example, one aspect that was really good in the convention is that there were guarantors. As I said, there were these people appointed to keep an eye on the processes, sitting on the deliberations, and make sure that nothing untoward happened, that there was no takeover by the experts, but also like exclusion of some individuals, things like that. And I remember one case where really I was struck by the importance of that role of the guarantors, which is precisely on this question of the referendum again, which I don't think that was a good episode. I don't think it went well. I think that the decision to vote for or against putting their proposals to a referendum took place late in the afternoon when everybody was very tired. When in the pandemic, people were in different rooms, you know, socially distanced, and they were asked to very, very quickly make a decision. This was so upsetting that many people burst into tears. So the co-president, one of the co-presidents said, okay, well, this is too intense. We're just going to take a mock vote now to take the temperature and we'll vote tomorrow morning instead. So they did this mock vote and most people didn't want to put their proposals to referendum, but I think it's partly because of the context and partly also because in the webinar that prepared that vote, they had talked about the referendum options, but the person in charge of laying out the options that the legal scholars had prepared didn't mention multiple question referenda, for example. And somebody in the chat, a citizen, said, what about multiple question referenda? Is that an option? So the guarantor says, oh, somebody in the chat is asking this. And so, and the one of the organizers replies, well, the legal team didn't think it was pertinent to put it on to explore it as a possibility because it's never been done in France. What? You know, how is that relevant? So fortunately, that's pretty much what the guarantor said. He said, Well, I don't think it's for the legal scholars to, you know, determine what's normatively desirable, that it should be the citizens who have the choice. And they kind of agreed, but at that point it was kind of late in the game, and that option of multiple referenda in the French context hadn't been discussed very much and was kind of swept under the rug by, I think, largely inadvertently by the legal scholars, who are very, you know, sort of like driven by precedent. And I think that was a missed opportunity, and you could see that the guarantor was capable of amplifying the sort of like weak signals coming from the citizens. And in an ideal world, this would have been expanded so that they would have found the time to talk more about the option of multiple choice referendums, and that didn't happen. But I think there are ways to learn from those mistakes and entrench safeguards, if you want.
Thank you, Hélène. Thank you, Eva. I think we're out of time, so we should collectively thank these two speakers.